Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Greenglass House by Kate Milford, narrated by Chris Henry Coffey.
Chapter 1. The Smugglers Inn. There's a right way to do things and a wrong way if you're going to run a hotel in a smuggler's town. You shouldn't make it a habit to ask too many questions, for one thing. And you probably shouldn't be in it for the money. Smugglers are always going to be flush with cash as soon as they find a buyer for the 8 cartons of fountain pen cartridges that write in illegal shades of green. But they never have money today. You should, if you're going to run a smuggler's hotel, get a big account book and assume that whatever you write in it, the reality is you're going to get paid in fountain pen cartridges. If you're lucky. You could just as easily get paid with something even more useless. Milo Pine did not run a smuggler's hotel, but his parents did. It was an inn, actually, a huge ramshackle manor house that looked as if it had been cobbled together from discarded pieces of a dozen mismatched mansions collected from a dozen different cities. It was called Greenglass House, and it sat on the side of a hill overlooking an inlet of harbors, a little district built half on the shore and half on the piers that jutted out into the river skid rack like the teeth of a comb. It was a long climb up to the inn from the waterfront by foot, or an only slightly shorter trip by the cable railway that led from the inn's private dock up the steep slope of Wilforber Hill. And of course the inn wasn't only for smugglers, but that was who turned up most often, so that was how Milo thought of it. Milo had lived at Greenglass House ever since he had been adopted by Nora and Ben Pine when he was a baby. It had always been home. And he was used to the bizarre folks who passed through the inn, some of them coming back every season like extended family who showed up to pinch your cheeks at holidays and then disappeared again. After 12 years, he was even getting pretty good at predicting who was going to show up when. Smugglers were like bugs or vegetables. They had their seasons, which was why it was so weird when the huge old bell on the porch, the one that was connected to the winch that drove the cable that in turn hauled the car up its tracks, started ringing. The old iron bell's tone changed with the seasons, too, and with the time of day. This evening, the first of winter vacation, was cold and brittle, and the snow had just begun to fall. Today, therefore, the bell itself had a brittle tone. It had a sound like a gulp of frigid air. Milo looked up from the coffee table, where he was working on a math problem. He liked to get his homework out of the way right off the bat so he could enjoy the holidays without thinking about school. He glanced at his mother, who was sprawled across the rag rug in front of the big stone fireplace, reading. "Someone's coming up?" he asked incredulously. Mrs. Pine got to her feet, tucked her book under her arm, padded across to the foyer, and peered out the window by the door. "Someone wants to. We better go start the winch." "But we never have guests the first week of vacation," Milo protested. He felt a vague unease start to rise in his stomach and tried to swallow it down. Vacation couldn't possibly get spoiled so quickly, could it? He'd only stepped off the launch that ferried the Quayside kids to and from school a few hours ago. "Well, not often we don't," Mrs. Pine said as she laced up her boots. "But that's not because we have a rule about it. It's just because that's the way it usually turns out." "But it's vacation." His mother shrugged and held out his coat. "Come on, kiddo, be a gentleman. Don't send your mom out into the cold alone." Ah, the all-powerful gentleman card. Still grumbling, Milo got to his feet, quietly whispering, "Vacation, vacation, vacation," as he slouched across to join her. He had just about finished his homework. That was supposed to be the end of responsibility for a while. The bell rang again. Milo gave in to his frustration, stopped in the middle of the foyer with one boot on, and gave a single furious yell with his hands clenched at his sides. Mrs. Pine waited with folded arms until he was finished. "Got that out of your system?" she asked gently. Milo scowled. "I know this isn't the usual routine," his mother added, "and I know you don't like it when things don't happen the way you expect." She bent to hunt in the catch-all basket beside the door for a flashlight. "But look, being surprised isn't always a bad thing." The fact that it sounded logical didn't change the way Milo felt, of course, but he nodded and finished getting dressed for the cold. He followed his mother out onto the porch and across the lawn to a break in the dark wall of bare white birches and blue-green firs that covered the hillside. There, in a pool of deeper shadow, the grass gave way to a stone landing. All his life, ever since he was really small, Milo had been very bothered by sudden changes of plan. More than bothered. Being surprised made him uneasy at the best of times. Now, tromping across the fresh snow in the bitter cold to haul a stranger up the hill, an unexpected stranger who was going to require him to work when all he really wanted was a quiet week or so with his parents and his house to himself, well, that made the uneasiness feel uncomfortably like panic. The flashlight's beam pierced the pool of shadow, which flickered and melted into butter gold. Mrs. Pine had turned on the light in the little pavilion hidden in the trees where the cable railway landed. The railway began 100 yards below at the river. There were other ways to get to the bottom of the gorge, or to get to the top if you were down. There was a steep and winding stair that ran more or less parallel to the railway and led to the same pavilion. There was also a road that snaked away from the inn and around the side of the hill down into the city proper, which was about a 20-minute drive away. But only Milo, his parents, and the inn's chef, Mrs. Caraway, ever really used the road. Guests didn't come from the direction of the city. Guests came by river, sometimes in their own boats, and sometimes by paying one of the dozens of old tars in the quayside harbors who'd ferry a person to Greenglass House in their equally aged boats for a few bucks. Given the option of being hauled up the steep hill in an antique conveyance that looked like a demented and oversized bumper car on rails, or climbing 310 steps, Milo had counted, they always chose the former. Inside the stone-floored pavilion were a bench, a shed, and the steel tracks of the railway. Mrs. Pine unlocked the shed, and Milo followed her inside to where the heavy cable that ran between the tracks looped around the giant spindle of the winch. Thanks to a complex mess of gears, once you got the winch going, it did all the work necessary to haul the single car up the slope. But it was old, and the lever tended to stick. Getting it moving was easier with two pairs of hands. Together, Milo and his mother grasped the lever. 1, 2, 3, Milo counted, and as one, they hauled it forward. The cold metal of the gears whined like an old dog, and then they started to turn. As Milo and Mrs. Pine waited for the rail car to click and clank its way to the top of the slope, he wondered what kind of person it was bringing up. Smugglers came in all kinds, and of course, sometimes the inn had guests who were sailors or travelers, and not smugglers at all. But not very often, and almost never in winter when the skid rack and its hidden inlets were so often frozen. While Milo was thinking, winding strings of glittering white firefly-sized lights came to life, outlining the pavilion and trailing off down the hill along the railing of the stairs. His mother straightened up from where she had just plugged them in. "So what do you think? An elf on the lam from the North Pole? A popgun runner? Eggnog bootlegger?" she asked. Best guess wins a brownie sundae. Loser makes it. What are those flower bulbs Grandma always sends you at Christmas that you love? Paper whites? Yeah, it's a guy with a cargo of those. And stockings, green ones with pink stripes. A low whine joined the creaking of the cable around the big spindle in the shed. You could tell where the rail car was by how the sounds it made changed. Milo pictured the misshapen old iron lamppost the car would be passing right about now. Green and pink stockings? Yeah, he probably knows it was a bad idea, but now he's stuck with them. He was forced to take the cargo on. No, tricked into it. And now, if he can't move it, he's ruined. He's already trying to figure out how to convince people to switch from baskets to striped stockings for Easter. Milo leaned over the pavilion railing and peered through the thickening snow, falling amongst the birches and icing the pine branches, searching for the first glimpse of the car and its passenger. It was still out of view, but from the vibration of the rails, he knew it was being hauled up the steepest part of the slope now. He's got meetings set up with people this week, too. Magazine writers, some weird TV star trying to see if he can make green and pink stripes a big fashion thing next year, and a sock puppet company. He leaned over the railing again, just far enough out that a few flakes of snow managed to make it past the roof onto his eyelashes. There it was. The blue metal nose of the rail car, with its silver racing stripes, painted a few years back by Milo and his father along with its name, Wilforber Whirlwind, on the sides. And then, a moment later, its passenger, a lanky man in a felt hat and a plain black coat. Milo could just make out a pair of oversized glasses with huge tortoiseshell rims on his nose. He wilted. The stranger looked disappointingly like somebody's grandfather, maybe even a bit like a schoolteacher. "I don't know," Mrs. Pine remarked, as if she'd read Milo's mind. "I could kind of believe that guy would take a chance on green and pink stripes." She ruffled his hair. "Come on, kiddo, put on your welcome face." "I hate the welcome face," Milo mumbled. But he straightened up and tried to look cheerful as the whirlwind made its final ascent to the pavilion. Up close, the stranger looked even more boring. Plain hat, plain coat, plain face, plain blue suitcase tucked in the boot of the car. Beneath the glasses, though, his eyes were bright and sharp as they flicked from Mrs. Pine to Milo and back. Milo felt himself stiffen. It always started this way. Whenever the Pines met someone new, you could just about see that person's thoughts. One of these things is not like the others. This stranger was hiding it better than most, for sure. There was no change in his expression, but that didn't mean he wasn't thinking it, too. How did a Chinese kid wind up in nag speak with that lady for a mom? Obviously adopted. The car came to a jerking stop at last, nearly sending the unexpected passenger's face straight into the Wilforber Whirlwind's padded dashboard. "Hi," Milo's mother beamed as the man clambered out of the car and brushed the accumulated snow from his shoulders. "Welcome to Greenglass House. I'm Nora Pine. This is my son, Milo." "Thank you," the stranger said, his voice just as boring as the rest of him. "My name's Vinge, Dicary Vinge." Well, Milo thought sourly, he had an interesting name at least. "I'll get your suitcase for you, Mr. Vinge." "Oh, that's all right," Mr. Vinge said quickly as Milo reached for it. "Let me carry that, it's quite heavy." He grasped the handle and pulled. It must have been heavy. Mr. Vinge had to put a foot up on the side of the car and push off for leverage. Which was when Milo's mother gave him a significant glance. Uncomprehending, Milo took another look at the stranger. Then he spotted it. One garishly striped sock, visible for just a moment before Mr. Vinge stumbled backwards with his suitcase. If anything, the orange and purple combination was even weirder than Milo's imaginary green and pink. "Looks like maybe I owe you a brownie sundae," Mrs. Pine whispered. Then louder, "This way, Mr. Vinge. Let's get you in out of the snow." Milo's father was waiting when they reached the porch. "Hey there," he said, reaching out to shake Mr. Vinge's hand and taking his suitcase with the other. "Ben Pine, rough night for travel, huh?" "Oh, it's not so bad," Mr. Vinge replied as he stepped inside and shucked off his coat. "You got in just in time," Milo's dad went on. "Weather report says we might see 7 or 8 inches of snow tonight." Dickery Vinge smiled. It was a vague smile, a quick smile, but it was there for just a moment. Like he was pleased about getting snowed in, basically alone in a remote lodge in a strange part of town. "You don't say." Milo thought the smile was weird, but then again, the guy did have a weird name and he was wearing weird socks. Maybe he was an oddball after all. "I put some coffee and hot chocolate on," Mr. Pine said as he led Mr. Vinge through the dining room to the stairs. "Let me show you to your room. Then we'll be glad to send something up, or you can warm yourself by the fire down here." "How long do you think you'll be staying?" Mrs. Pine called after him. Mr. Vinge paused, 1 foot on the bottom step. "I suppose that depends. Do you need to know right now?" "Nope, you're our only guest at the moment." Mr. Vinge nodded. "Then I guess I'll let you know." Milo followed his father and their guest up the staircase. The inn had 5 main floors. The living room, dining room, and kitchen. All of them big open rooms that flowed from one to the next were on the first floor. The Pines' living space was on the second. The guest rooms took up the 3rd, 4th, and 5th floors. The staircase that connected them was wide, with carved banisters on both sides. On each floor, there was a landing and a turn so that the stair doubled back on itself, and each landing had a huge stained glass window. Mr. Pine led Mr. Vinge to the 3rd floor, where the doors to the 4 guest rooms stood open. "Your pick, Mr. Vinge. Any preference?" Their guest wandered down the hall, peering into each room as he passed. He paused at the end, where the door to the old dumbwaiter was, then turned back to Milo and his father. Except Milo had the impression that Mr. Vinge wasn't exactly looking at them, but past them. Milo turned and saw only the stained glass window and the snowy night beyond, tinged in shades of pale, pale greens, celery and celadon, and tones like old bottle glass. "This one will be fine," Mr. Vinge said after a moment, nodding at the room to his left. "Sounds good," Mr. Pine set the blue suitcase just inside the door. "Want us to send up a hot drink?" Before Mr. Vinge could answer, the brittle peal of the railway bell rang out again. Milo stared at his father, shocked. "Another one?" he demanded before he could stop himself. Then he clapped his hands over his mouth, sure that had to have sounded horribly rude. "I'm so sorry," Mr. Pine was already saying to the guest, shooting dagger eyes at Milo. But Mr. Vinge didn't appear to have noticed Milo's faux pas. He looked just as shocked as Milo felt.
Is that the bell I rang?" he asked in a strange voice.
"It sure is," Milo's father said. "Sounds like we have another guest." He turned to head back downstairs, flicking Milo on his left ear as he went. Not hard enough to be painful, but just enough to let him know that even if Mr. Vinge had missed Milo's rudeness, his father hadn't. "Shall we send up coffee or hot chocolate, something to snack on?" Mr. Vinge frowned, then shook his head. "No thanks. I'll come down in a few minutes. I confess, I'm curious to see who else is traveling tonight." Milo's father took the stairs 2 at a time and caught his wife just as she was about to go back out into the snow. "We've got it, we've got it," he said. At any other time, Milo might have felt annoyed at being volunteered, never mind that if one guest threatened to spoil his vacation, two spoiled it for sure. But now, the sheer improbability of two separate guests showing up at this time of year made him more curious than upset. Not only that, Dakari Vinge had been shocked when that bell rang. On one hand, he was right to be shocked that another guest was on the way. On the other hand, how could he possibly have known the inn was usually deserted at this time of year? Unless, Milo thought as he pulled on his boots, Mr. Vinge was here because he figured he'd have the place to himself. That was the moment Milo first started thinking maybe there was something odd going on. But then his father opened the door, and a knife stroke of windy night cut into the foyer. Milo zipped up his coat and stumbled out into the cold after his dad, trying to walk so that his steps matched the footprints Mr. Pine left in the accumulating snow. They had to send the Wilforber Whirlwind back down the hill, Milo's mother having reasonably assumed it had made its last upward trip for a while. "What do you figure?" Mr. Pine asked as they watched the blue car disappear over the slope. "I gotta tell you, and don't tell your mom, I was really looking forward to a few weeks off. I'm not complaining, I'm just saying, I thought I was off duty for a while." "I know," Milo exploded. "I already did my homework and everything." "What's the deal with Mr. Vinge? I didn't get around to asking what he does or what brought him here, did you?" Milo shook his head. "He's got some pretty crazy socks on, that's all I know." His father nodded seriously. That was one of the many great things about Milo's dad. He always took whatever you said seriously. Milo didn't have to explain why it seemed meaningful that a guy who appeared to be so boring and normal wore such bizarre socks. His dad would get it. The engine that drove the cable jerked to a halt. The whirlwind had reached the bottom of the slope. A moment later, the bell rang again to signal that the passenger was aboard and ready to begin the trip upward. Mr. Pine disappeared into the shed for a moment to throw the lever. Milo and his father leaned on the railing side by side in silence, staring through the trees and waiting for the first flash of blue. That was another great thing about Milo's dad. You could hang out with him and say nothing and still feel like you'd spent time together. Milo's mom wasn't good at that. Oh, she always had interesting things to say, and they had fun conversations every time they talked. But his dad was good at quiet. The snow fell, trying to blanket trees and ground and night with silence, while the winch and the cable and the rails and the car made their familiar mechanical noises, as if they were having a conversation while they brought up the new guest. And then, at last, there was the Wilforber Whirlwind, and inside it, hunched under a vivid blue umbrella topped with snow, was a lady. As the rail car passed under one of the old iron lampposts, the light falling through the umbrella seemed to turn her hair blue, too. She looked pretty young to Milo, or younger than his parents, anyway. She smiled and waved as the whirlwind approached, and Milo found himself smiling and waving back. The car came to a lurching stop, and the lady swung her umbrella over to one side, knocking off the snow and closing it up. Her hair stayed blue, a darker shade than the metallic cobalt of the rail car, but blue nonetheless. "Hi," she said, her voice bright. "Sorry to drag you out into the snow." "No problem," Mr. Pine said, offering a hand to help her out. "It's what we're here for. I'm Ben Pine, and this is my son Milo." "Georgiana Moselle, Georgie," the blue-haired girl said. "Thanks." "Can I carry your bag for you?" Milo asked. She nodded, pleased, and pointed to a carpet bag in the boot of the car. "Sure thing. Thanks, Milo." Milo hauled it out and started back through the trees to the inn. Before Mr. Pine followed, he paused to send the rail car back down the hill, muttering, "Just in case." Inside, there were hot drinks waiting. Milo could smell cider simmering on the stove the second he opened the door. Mr. Vinge was waiting too. As Mrs. Pine came to the foyer and introduced herself, he peered around the side of one of the big chairs in the living room, gave Georgie a curious look, then disappeared back into the depths of the chair. "Let's get you a room first. Then there's coffee, tea, hot chocolate, and cider," Mrs. Pine said as their second guest stepped out of her green rubber boots. "Ben, what room did you put Mr. Vinge in?" Georgie stopped dead in the act of pulling up her woolen socks and gave Mrs. Pine the oddest look Milo had ever seen. It was as if her face was divided in half. The bottom part was all innocent smile, but the top half was wide-eyed in unmistakable disbelief. "You have another guest?" Mr. Vinge leaned around his chair again, smiling blandly behind his oversized glasses. "Decary Vinge. Just arrived myself." "Georgie Moselle," said the young lady with the blue hair. The odd expression flickered on her face, like she really didn't want it there anymore, but knew it would look weird if she stopped smiling right now. Neither she nor Mr. Vinge made any effort to shake hands. They just stared at each other as if each was trying to figure out something about the other. Milo glanced over to see if his parents had noticed this bit of awkwardness, but somehow they seemed to have missed it. "Mr. Vinge is in 3E, Mr. Pine said to his wife, busy with his own coat and boots. "You don't mind showing Miss Moselle up?" "Glad to. Milo, you want to bring that bag?" "Sure." Milo watched the two guests continue to size each other up. Then Georgie turned away abruptly and followed Mrs. Pine toward the stairs. Milo trailed after. "Third floor okay?" his mom asked. "Hardly seems worth it to make you hike up any higher, not when there's only the two of you." "Oh, I don't know," Georgie said brightly. "How often does a girl get a whole floor to herself? Might be fun." Fun? Why on earth would anyone want to walk up three flights if she didn't have to? Also, Milo knew from experience, having camped out in every room at some point or another, that it was pretty creepy being the only person on a floor. The inn made noises. Floorboards creaked, old window panes rattled, hinges groaned. But of course his mother was not about to tell a guest she couldn't hike up an extra flight of stairs if she wanted to. So they kept on going up to the fourth floor. While the stained glass window on the third floor was done in shades of pale green, the one here was mostly blue, cobalt and robin's egg and navy and powder and turquoise, with a few bits and pieces here and there that seemed, with the dark sky behind them, to match the guest's hair precisely. Georgie Moselle beamed at it. "Look at that. Obviously I belong here." Mrs. Pine waved an arm. "Any room you like, then." "I forgot to ask, how long do you think you'll be staying?" "Not sure, a week, maybe two?" After a quick look inside each, Georgie chose a room at the far end. Milo followed her to 4W and set the carpet bag on the folding luggage rack just inside the door. Or at least, that's what he meant to do. Instead, he dropped the bag into thin air, and it fell 3 feet or so to the floor with a thud. There was no mistaking the crunch of something breaking inside it. Georgie was kneeling next to the bag before Milo had even decided whether to apologize or scream. "I'm so sorry," he babbled, staring from the bag to the luggage rack, which, for some inexplicable reason, stood to the right of the door rather than to the left where it should have been. Every room with a W had a door that opened inward and to the right, so the luggage rack was always on the left. "It's fine," Georgie was saying. "Don't worry about it." "But something broke," Milo protested. Georgie was busy throwing clothes and toiletries that appeared to have been shoved randomly into the bag out onto the floor in search of whatever had broken. Milo stared in horror as the pile grew. Jeans, pajamas, a jar of face cream, underwear. I'll get a towel or something, he said helplessly. A book with a bent cover, a water-stained journal with loose pages escaping to flutter across the room, a plastic zipper bag of makeup and lipsticks, and then there it was. Georgie lifted two dripping pieces of broken pink-faceted glass. The smell hit Milo a fraction of a second later, alcohol and something spicy, flowery. He'd broken a bottle of perfume. "Oh, my God!" Mrs. Pine exclaimed from the hallway. "Oh, I am so..." She gagged involuntarily and ran down the hall. A moment later, she returned with a waste bin from one of the other rooms. "Throw it in here. We'll replace it, of course. I'm so sorry. I'll take anything that needs washing and do it up right away." Georgie sighed and dropped the glass carefully into the bin. "It's not a big deal. Please don't trouble yourself about it. I don't know why I shoved the bottle in the bottom of the bag like that anyway." She gathered her clothes up in her arms, dumped them on the yellow knitted blanket on the bed, and began to sort them into piles. Milo's mother gave him a sharp, questioning look. He paused in the act of picking up the rest of Georgie's belongings. "The luggage rack's on the wrong side," he protested, jabbing an accusatory finger at the offending piece of furniture. "They're always opposite the way the door opens. Who moved it?" "Milo..." Mrs. Pine held out the waste bin expectantly. He sighed and deposited Georgie's things on the desk, which, fortunately, was right where it was supposed to be. Then he took the bin and escaped down the hall. He'd gotten all the way to the utility closet on the second floor, where he emptied the bin of its flowery, vile-smelling, eye-burning contents, when he realized he still had Georgie Moselle's book under one arm. Great. Well, he'd have to face her again sooner or later. Milo sighed and tried not to dwell too much on how the luggage rack not being where it was supposed to be, on top of vacation not happening the way it was supposed to happen, made it seem kind of like the world was trying to drive him crazy. He started back up the stairs, which was when the bell rang for the third time. Milo turned abruptly and sprinted down the staircase to the main floor past a staring Mr. Vinge, narrowly avoiding plowing into both his father and the silver coffee pot he was holding. "I'll get it," he shrieked at the top of his lungs. There were two of them this time. It was hard to tell who was least happy about that fact. The guests uncomfortably sharing the rail car bench as they got coated little by little with snow, or the Wilforber whirlwind itself, which was definitely not meant to carry so much weight and was squealing abnormally as it approached the platform. It wasn't that the guests themselves were exceptionally heavy. The boot of the car was stuffed full of so much stuff that the pile of it was actually taller than the smaller of the car's passengers. It had to have been packed in there by a master, because Milo couldn't rightly see how it hadn't all spilled out and tumbled straight down to the bottom of the steep incline. There were suitcases, briefcases, garment bags, something that looked like a telescope case. Guests number 3 and 4 were scrambling to get out of the car before it had even come to a stop. They made Milo think right away of characters from a nursery rhyme, something out of Mother Goose or Aunt Lucy's counterpane book, "On a Dark and Rainy Night, Side by Side, Mr. Up and Mr. Down Had to Share a Ride." And much like Mr. Up and Mr. Down in the rhyme, these two looked like they'd be at each other's throats if they shared that ride even a minute longer. The man Milo thought of as Mr. Down was short and dark-haired and looked like an angry schoolteacher. The other one, if Milo was honest about it, was probably too angular to really stand in properly for Mr. Up. Also, She was a woman. But she looked like an angry schoolteacher, too, white-haired and haughty. Why did everyone look like schoolteachers while he was supposed to be on vacation? Nonetheless, Milo raised a hand in greeting, regarding the two newcomers cautiously as they disembarked. They both looked about ready to snap. Welcome to... Mr. Down pulled something from the car, and the entire mass came undone. Baggage, most of it expensive-looking mauve brocade luggage, spilled down, bouncing across the platform and clunking onto the steel rails. Mrs. Up, who had been about to come around to where Milo stood, froze for a second. Her face went still, then it got red, then purple, then a shade something between gray and blue. Then she started yelling. Mr. Down straightened to his full diminutive height, his face already turning pink, and then he started yelling too. They continued bawling at each other, louder and louder, standing amid the ruins of the luggage tower. Milo wasn't even sure they were shouting in English. If they were, they didn't seem to be bothering to use real words. "Excuse me," he said tentatively. The shouting went on as if he weren't there. "Excuse me," Milo said again louder. Then, "Excuse me!" Without a pause, the two of them whirled down Milo and directed their yelling at him. He tried to listen. Then he tried to interrupt. Finally, he did what his mother did whenever Milo went on what she called a tear and couldn't be calmed down. He clasped his hands behind his back, made a face as if he was paying really close attention to whatever incomprehensible things these two were saying, and waited. Amazingly, it worked. Little by little, Mr. Down and Mrs. Up ran out of steam. As the torrent of angry words subsided, Milo realized the whole argument seemed to be a matter of whose luggage had been taking up too much space in the boot. At last, they stood there silently on either side of the rail car, he with his arms folded across his chest, and she with her hands balled into fists at her sides. Milo smiled a big welcoming smile and pointed to the path that led up to the inn. "Right this way," he said, as if he hadn't just had to wait out a storm of screeching. "Come right on up." They each shot one last crabby look at the other. Then Mrs. Up gave a noise like a growl and turned to the mess of gear strewn across the pavilion floor. She picked out an armful of mauve carry-on bags and strung them across her shoulders until she had mostly disappeared under them. "Young man, could I trouble you to bring my suitcase and my garment bag?" Milo nodded, and she made a face that was pretty close to a smile, then stamped out of the shelter, wincing with each step as her patent leather heels sank into the snow. Mr. Down waited with his arms still folded until she was out of earshot, then gave a giant, displeased sigh.
"Oh, I was under the impression that this would be a quiet sort of place at this time of year," he said, looking at Milo as if he personally were responsible for giving out wrong information. Milo shrugged. "You and me both. I'm supposed to be on vacation. Inn's that way. Can I help you with those?"
"No, thank you. I'll manage." The short fellow gave another sigh and collected the rest of the gear piece by piece. Then, looking like a pack animal, he started down the path too. Milo walked once around the pavilion to make sure there were no forgotten bags or cases hiding in corners or lying on the rails before following the two combatants toward the inn. He slung Mrs. Up's garment bag over his shoulder by its hook and grasped the handle of her rolling suitcase. Then, just at the edge of the woods where the path reached the lawn, he paused and listened. There was a sound behind him, coming from the wooded hill, but not from the railway. This was a hollow sound, not a mechanical one. Even muffled by the snow, it was familiar, though Milo couldn't quite believe he was hearing it.
Someone was coming up the stairs. And from the pace of the footfalls, that someone was coming up fast, practically sprinting up the last dozen steps. Milo jogged back to the edge of the platform and peered down into the snow swirling through the trees. By the uneven glow from the occasional lamppost and the twisted strings of fairy lights, he saw that a dark figure was, in fact, approaching. And that figure was not merely sprinting up the stairs. He or she was taking them two at a time, which, apart from being a fairly dangerous thing to do on snow-slick steps, seemed as though it ought to be physically impossible. There were, after all, more than 300 of them. It was an exhausting climb under the best of circumstances. He waited for the person to slow down. It didn't happen. The newcomer jumped the last three steps to land at the top, looking fresh as a daisy. A snow-covered daisy in a black knit cap, carrying a truly gigantic backpack on its shoulders, and wearing pink lip gloss. "Hey there," she said, grinning at Milo with only a little flush on her cheeks. "Didn't mean to startle you. Looking for the Greenglass House, supposed to be somewhere hereabouts?" "Yeah." Milo stared down the incline, still trying to figure out how she wasn't red-faced and dying of exhaustion. "Yeah, right this way. I'm Milo. My folks run the inn." "Clements O'Candler," she replied, holding out a hand with gray painted fingernails. "My friends call me Clem." Inside the inn, chaos had taken over. Mr. Down and Mrs. Up were still yelling at each other, only now they were doing so in the middle of the living room. He gesturing angrily with a telescope case held as if it were a sword, she with an embroidered bag clutched to her chest like a shield, and both with their wet shoes dripping slush onto the rag rug. Mr. Vinge stood in the corner, holding his mug defensively in front of his chest. Georgie Moselle sat on the hearth with her elbows on her knees and her eyebrows drawn up high on her forehead. It seemed they couldn't possibly go up any higher, but when Clem Candler trailed inside after Milo, they did. "Yes," Milo thought grouchily, "another one. Get used to it. If I have to, you have to." Mr. Pine was trying unsuccessfully to get in between the two shrieking newcomers, and Milo's mother was pacing at the bar between the dining room and the kitchen with the phone to her ear. Clem Candler hung up her coat and arranged her shoes next to Mr. Vinge's without taking her eyes off the yelling duo in the next room. She took off her cap and shook out a head full of short red hair. "Pretty lively crowd," she muttered. Meanwhile, Mr. Pine had had enough. Milo saw it coming and braced himself. His father could yell when he wanted to. "All right," Mr. Pine bellowed. His voice ricocheted off every surface in the room. Somewhere in the dining room, a glass fell from its shelf and shattered on the hardwood floor. "That's enough from both of you." Mr. Down and Mrs. Up fell grudgingly silent. "That's better. Behave yourselves like adults, or I may just discover we're all booked up," Mr. Pine continued, fixing them one by one with a severe glare. "Do I make myself clear?" He waited for a reluctant nod from each, then gestured toward the wooden stand in the foyer where the guest register lay open. "You first, madam. Your name?"
"Mrs. Eglantine Hereward."
"And yours, sir?"
"Dr. Wilbur Gowervine."
"And you, miss?"
"Clements Candler."
"And how long is everyone planning to stay?" The three new guests hesitated. Just like the first two, none of them seemed to have made up his or her mind. Mr. Pine sighed.
"No matter. Milo, you want to do the honors?"
"Kay." Milo kicked off his boots, picked up Eglantine Hereward's suitcase and garment bag again, and led the way up the stairs. Clem followed silently but cheerily in her stocking feet. Mrs. Hereward gave a grandiose sniff and trailed after them. Wilbur Gowervine made a big production of collecting his gear. Then he followed as well, the long telescope case bouncing off the banister with each step. Milo paused on the second landing under the pale green window, and he and Clem waited for the other two to catch up. "This is the first floor of guest rooms," he said when Mrs. Hereward and Dr. Gowervine reached them. "You can pick whichever you like, except 3E. That one's occupied. It's the one with the door closed." The three guests looked at one another. Clem waved a hand and gave the other two a dazzling smile. "You go ahead." Mrs. Hereward gave her a curt little nod and stalked down the hallway. While she was examining the open room at the far end, Dr. Gowervine carried his belongings into the nearest open room and dumped them on the floor. "I'll take this one," he called. While the tall old lady made a big production of deciding between the two remaining rooms, Clem leaned over and spoke quietly. "Say, Milo, I don't suppose there are upstairs rooms that are available, are there?"
"Well, sure, lots. Why?"
He supposed it wasn't really any of his business, but Clem didn't seem bothered. "I need my exercise," she explained. "I get a little stir-crazy if I don't get it, and what with the snow, I can't imagine I'm going to be putting in any runs outside anytime soon." "Would it be a pain in the neck for your mom and dad if I took one on another floor?"
"Not at all. In fact, I don't think there's anybody on 5. 2 flights up? 5W has a really cool window with painted glass, if you like that kind of thing."
"Perfect." Down the hall, Mrs. Hereward peered out the door of 3N, next to Mr. Vinge's room.
"Young man, could I have the rest of my things brought up?"
"Sure, ma'am." Milo turned back to Clem, but she had already disappeared up the staircase. Chapter 2. Meddy. By the time Milo had squared away Mrs. Hereward's luggage, had checked in with Clem on the fifth floor, and had gotten himself a mug of hot chocolate from the saucepan on the stove and a few marshmallows to top it off, he was starting to feel out of control again. It was late, and from throughout the inn came the sounds of strangers. The house's noises were different. Even the air smelled different. It should have smelled like winter and snow and fireplace and hot chocolate. Those aromas were still there, but they were buried now under the scents of Mrs. Hereward's wet wool coat, Georgie Mazel's broken bottle of perfume, and a faint whiff of tobacco from the pipe Dr. Gowervine had smoked out on the screen porch. Milo slid onto one of the benches at the dining room table, where just a few hours ago he'd eaten a perfectly normal dinner before all the guests had started pouring in out of the snow. His mother muttered a goodbye into the phone she'd been glued to for the last 20 minutes, hung it up, and dropped onto the bench next to him.
"How you doing, kiddo?"
He growled into his cup. "Well, don't panic. That was Mrs. Caraway. She and Lizzie are coming back to help out. We're going to do our best to make sure you get your vacation."
"They are?"
Mrs. Caraway was the inn's chef, and her daughter Lizzie, who owned a bake shop, had come to help out once or twice before during especially busy times.
"When?"
"Tonight, if the roads are clear enough, but late. They're going to have to drive really slowly." She put an arm around his shoulder. "You want to stay up with me? I seem to recall owing you a brownie sundae." Normally, Milo loved to sit up late with his folks in front of the fire. Sometimes they would read. Sometimes they would play Scrabble or cards. Tonight, though, Milo peered over his mug into the living room. Mr. Vinge had gone back upstairs. Dr. Gowervine had done the same after his pipe. And Mrs. Hereward hadn't come down again at all. But Georgie Mazel and Clem Candler were both sitting there with hot drinks and green mugs.
Blue-haired Georgie was curled up on the couch, her drink on the end table beside her elbow, and a cigar box in her lap. She had a roll of black tape in one hand, and she was wrapping it carefully around the edges of the box. Red-headed Clem sat on the rag rug, just barely within view from where Milo was. She had a roll of white tape, and she was wrapping up her ankles. Evidently, her climb up to the inn hadn't been quite as painless as it had looked. Still, they were being quiet, and this might just be his last evening of peace. He could always go upstairs to the family's private space, but his parents would be down here taking care of the guests, and too much quiet and loneliness wouldn't make him feel any better. "I'll go get something to read. Be right back." He was halfway up the first flight of stairs when he remembered that he hadn't returned Georgie's book, the one he'd taken accidentally from her room earlier that evening. He stopped, foot poised over the next step, and patted down his pockets. Oh no, what did I... There was really only one place he could have left it. He'd had it when he'd run out to answer the rail car bell. He didn't recall having it when he'd led the three new guests up to their rooms, or when he'd come back down to get Mrs. Hereward's luggage, which meant it had to be outside, probably in the pavilion. Milo flung himself back down the stairs and into the foyer, where he grabbed his boots and ducked outside before anyone could ask him where he was going. He skidded across the porch, passing his father, who was busy stacking firewood under a tarp, and sprinted down the path and into the woods. The fairy lights were still on, along the roof and down the railing of the long staircase, but now they glowed under a half-inch glaze of snow. Milo found the paperback right away, wedged between the Wilforber whirlwind and the edge of the wooden floor. He must have dropped it when the tower of luggage had come tumbling down. He tugged the book free and tucked it in his back pocket, and he was just about to head back inside when he spotted something else on the steel tracks. It looked like a blue leather wallet, only bigger. Milo climbed down onto the rails behind the car and picked it up. And that's how he found the first map. It was tucked into the left-hand pocket of the leather wallet, folded into quarters. The paper was old and green-tinged, the way the copper pots in the inn's kitchen were tinted green from verdigris. Only Milo had never seen paper turn green like that. He unfolded it carefully with cold fingers. It was brittle and delicate, and didn't look as if it could stand much more folding and unfolding, but he could tell it had once been thick and expensive. Milo held it up so that the light from the closest lamppost shone through, and he could just make out a watermark. It looked like a wrought iron gate, but slightly warped and wrenched out of its original shape. It was then, with the page lit up from behind, that Milo realized what he was looking at. He turned and hopped across the rails to the shed that housed the big winch, turned on the overhead light, and held the paper up again to get a better look. It's a funny thing about maps. You don't have to know what they're supposed to represent to know you're looking at one. A map is pretty much unmistakable. Draw one on a napkin, sketch one into the mud with the toe of your shoe, line up the flakes of your cereal with your spoon to make one in your breakfast bowl. Maps come in all kinds, but they all still manage to look like maps. And the brittle, watermarked paper Milo was holding was definitely a map, even if it didn't look like any map he'd ever seen. At least, not at first. There were no lines for streets, no boxes for houses, nothing to mark the features of a city or a town or even a lonely road winding through the countryside. Instead, there were shapeless washes of blue layered one on top of the other, so that in some places the paper was merely blue-tinged, and in others the color deepened by degrees to china blue and ultramarine and royal and navy. Here and there, centered in the bands of shading, were groups of green ink dots,
small clusters of 2 and 3 where the blue was lightest, and larger clusters of 9 or 10 or more where it was darkest. In one corner was a group of nearly white curls, like slightly twisted triangles gathered together. In another corner was the shape of a bird, with an arrow pointing away from one outstretched wing. Milo knew a thing or two about maps. This, of course, came from 12 years of growing up around smugglers and sailors. And as he stared at the paper in his hands, he realized it reminded him of a very specific sort of map, one that he saw fairly often. It looked like a nautical chart, the kind that ship's navigators use. Yes, a nautical chart. That was exactly what it was, with the shadings of blue and the green dots meant to represent the different depths of the waterway. The bird shape must be the compass rose, which would mean the wing with the arrow was supposed to be pointing north. He turned the page so that the arrow pointed up, but that didn't make the waterway any more familiar. He turned it again and again, trying to find the orientation that would transform it into something recognizable. The Skid Rack River, or the Magathy Bay it emptied into, or one of the Skid Rack's inland tributaries. But no matter which way he held the map, it didn't look like any river or bay Milo knew of. Then, outside in the pavilion, he heard a voice muttering curses. He put his eye to the crack between the door and its frame. A person wrapped in a heavy coat crossed Milo's view, head hunched low into the collar. A short, sharp breeze kicked up, swirling snow around the figure. It wasn't his mother or father, but between the snow and the twinkling lights, he couldn't quite work out which of the guests it was. The person strode out of view and back in again, making a circuit of the pavilion, then hopped down onto the tracks inside it. Milo heard footsteps crunching over the stones between the steel rails. He or she had to be looking for the leather wallet Milo had just found. The logical thing to do would be to step out and announce that he'd found it. It was, after all, the property of one of the guests, and at some point, he was going to have to give it back. Still, when the dark shadow swung itself back up off the tracks, something made Milo edge deeper into the shed and tuck himself as far behind the winch as he could. He held his breath and waited. Long minutes passed without any sound from outside. At last, Milo tiptoed back over to the door and put his eye up to the crack again. The unknown person was gone. As quietly as he could, he refolded the map and tucked it into the leather wallet. He slipped it into his other back pocket, making certain it was hidden by his coat. Then, when he was sure, absolutely sure, that he was alone in the pavilion again, he crept out of the shed. Whoever it had been, he or she had left footprints, but already the swirling snow was busy erasing them. Inside the inn was basically just as he'd left it. His mom was at the dining room table. In the living room, Georgie Moselle was on the couch with her cigar box, and Clem Candler sat on the rag rug, stretching her taped-up legs. Mrs. Pine looked up from her book. "Milo, where'd you go?" Milo yanked off his hat and looked around as he unwound his scarf, sure he must be missing someone. "Someone went outside after me. Who was it?" Now Georgie and Clem looked up. "Nobody else came through this room," Georgie said. "We didn't see anybody," she looked at Clem. "Right? Or was I just not paying attention?" "I didn't notice anyone leave. Not this way, anyhow." The red-headed girl stood and stretched. "Well, that's it for me, folks. See you in the morning." Then, silently, she ran up the stairs 2 at a time. "What about Dad?" Milo asked. Even though he was certain that whoever he'd seen, it hadn't been his father. "He was outside, right?" "He came in right after you went out. He's upstairs now," Mrs. Pine frowned. "What's wrong?" Milo opened his mouth, then shut it again. "Nothing," he said at last. taking off his coat and boots and sliding onto the bench across from his mother.
Somebody was walking outside, that's all. Thought they must have come in this way.
Good grief, Milo's mother slid off the bench and headed toward the foyer to put on her own cold weather gear. Guess I'd better make sure nobody's gonna freeze out there.
Nobody's gonna freeze, Milo protested. It's not like you can miss the house.
But the door was already swinging shut behind Mrs. Pine, leaving Milo alone with Georgie Mazel. For a few minutes, they ignored each other. Georgie continued messing around with her cigar box and her black tape, and Milo sipped his hot chocolate, acutely aware of the paperback tucked in his back pocket. When he'd emptied his mug, he finally spoke up.
"Hey, Miss Moselle," he asked awkwardly, "can I get you anything? More hot chocolate?"
"No, thanks," Georgie replied. "Don't worry about me, and you can call me Georgie if you want." Milo paused on his way to the kitchen and looked at the box she was occupied with.
"What is that, by the way?"
She held it up. "Pinhole camera."
"A camera? Made out of a cigar box?"
That was enough to distract him from both the empty mug in his hand and the book in his pocket.
"What's a pinhole camera?"
"You can make a camera out of just about anything," Georgie said as she handed the box to him. "As long as there's an opening for light and a surface to capture it and turn it into an image. Do you know anything about photography?"
"Nope."
Milo turned it over in his hands. Georgie had taped up all the edges, but there was a hole cut into the front of it. He tried to look inside, but all he could see was darkness.
"There's nothing to see right now," Georgie told him. "When I'm sure I've sealed up all the light leaks, I'll put photo paper in there. That hole will be the aperture."
She took the box back and smiled at it. "I've always wanted to make one. I've just never tried before. Of course, this one isn't finished yet, but I think it'll work."
"It needs a name, though."
Milo laughed. "A name? For a camera?"
"Sure. All the coolest ones have great names. Hasselblad, Rolei, Voigtlander, Leica."
She held up the box between them as if her palm were a pedestal and declared, "I shall call it the Lansdegown." She gave Milo a sharp, mock-accusing look. "Unless you think it doesn't deserve a name. Unless in your vast cigar box camera wisdom, you think it's not good enough."
"No, no, it does, it does."
He forced himself to look solemnly at the box.
"Lansdegown it is. What's it mean, though?"
"Lansdegown?" Georgie tilted her head. "Don't you know?"
He thought hard. "Nope."
"I bet you do," she said with a little smile. "I bet you've just forgotten. See if you can remember what Lansdegown means, and then you can tell me if you think it's the right name for my camera." Milo reached into his pocket and held out the paperback. Surely she wouldn't be angry. She would understand it had only been a mistake.
"I took this when we were cleaning up. I didn't realize I had it in my hand. I meant to bring it back to you earlier," he said, "but I forgot. I'm awfully sorry."
"Aha! I thought I'd forgotten to pack it," Georgie smiled. "No problem. You ever read it?"
How odd. All that running around with this book, and he hadn't even noticed what it was called.
The cover was plain, just heavy red paper with the title stamped on it in gray letters. "The Raconteur's Commonplace Book," Milo read, pronouncing the unfamiliar word carefully.
"I don't think so. What's a raconteur?"
"It's an old-fashioned word for a storyteller. This is a collection of folklore from hereabouts. You might know some of the stories." Georgie took the book and flipped through it, then handed it back open to the second chapter. "Know this one?"
"The Game of Maps?" Milo shook his head again. "I don't think so."
He held it out to her, but the blue-haired girl just waved her hand.
"Read a few. See what you think. My feelings won't be hurt if you decide you aren't into it. She smiled again. But maybe you wound up with it for a reason.
Like what?
She shrugged. Don't know. Read it, then you tell me. I think you'll at least like the way it starts.
Milo looked down at the story Georgie had picked out and skimmed the first line. There was a city that could not be mapped, and inside it, a house that could not be drawn. Before he realized it, he'd read the whole page. He looked up to find Georgie Mazel grinning at him. Good stuff, right? Maybe. He set the book aside just long enough to go into the kitchen and refill his cup of hot chocolate. Then he hunkered down in one of his favorite places to go when there were guests in the house. A high-backed love seat facing one of the huge bow windows that overlooked the grounds beyond the front porch. When he sat there, the back of the seat made a sort of wall that separated him from whatever was going on in the rooms behind him and provided just a little bit of privacy. Curled into one corner, he started reading, this time from the beginning of the book. The rain had not stopped for a week, and the roads that led to the inn were little better than rivers of muck. This, at least, is what Captain Frost said when he tramped indoors, coated in the yellow mud peculiar to that part of the city and hollering for his breakfast. The rest of the guests sighed. Perhaps today, they had thought, perhaps today their unnatural captivity would end. But the bellowing man calling for eggs and burnt toast meant that, for another day at least, 15 people would remain prisoners of the river Skidrack and the new rivers that had once been roads and the rain. No wonder Georgie had thought he might like it. Substitute snow for rain and subtract a few people, and the author might have been writing about Greenglass House. In the book, however, one of the guests, a man named Finn, suggested that they pass the time by telling stories. In more civilized places, when travelers find themselves sharing a fire and a bottle of wine, they sometimes choose to share something of themselves, too, Finn told them. And then, wonder of wonders, no strangers remain, only companions sharing a hearth and a bottle. The wind and rain rattled the window panes as the folks gathered in the parlor looked from one to the next. The young girl in her embroidered silk stole, the twin gentlemen with the tattooed faces, the gaunt woman with her nervous gloved hands constantly moving, the other woman, gaunter still and hidden beneath two layers of voluminous shawls, whose red-brown skin showed in small flashes when her wraps did not quite move along with her. If you will listen, Finn said, swirling his glass, I will tell the first tale. Then, perhaps, if you find it worth the trade, you will give me one of yours. Listen. The guests in the book agreed, of course, and in the next chapter, Finn told the story of the game of maps. There was a city that could not be mapped, and inside it, a house that could not be drawn. Three stories later, the door flew open, and a snow-covered Mrs. Pine tramped in, followed by more snow people, Mrs. Caraway and her daughter Lizzie. Milo hunkered deeper into the love seat and pretended to be so absorbed in his reading that he didn't notice them as they piled brown paper bags full of groceries on the dining room table and started peeling off coats and boots. He glanced at a little clock on the side table next to the love seat. It was nearly midnight. The couch where Georgie Mazel had been sitting was empty. Sometime in the past hour and a half, while Milo had been reading about the unmappable house and the maker of reliquaries, she had disappeared. Milo had been so absorbed in the stories, he hadn't heard her going up to bed or his mother coming in from the cold and going back outside again. Milo! It would, he thought sadly, probably be the last time in a while that he'd be able to read in peace like that. He set the book down, sighed, and levered himself up out of his seat.
Yes, Mom?
Merry almost, kiddo. Mrs. Caraway, sock-footed, paused in the act of gathering up the bags again to give Milo a quick wave, then headed for the kitchen. Lizzie, who was 20-ish, collected the rest of the groceries and followed her mother, giving Milo a smile and nod. Mrs. Pine jogged into the kitchen after Mrs. Caraway. Odette, I'll put that stuff away. You guys get some rest. Ben should have your rooms ready for you. Milo, can you take care of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.